Jesus, I thank you so much. Whether we're having microphone problems or other technical issues, you are in charge, you are in control, and we want to glorify you. God, I do pray that those who are not here will be able to hear well enough to be able to participate. But God, before we start, every note and word sung, let every word that is said, let all that we do bring praise and glory and honor to you. Holy Spirit, we ask that you empower us in this room to do that. We pray in your name, Jesus. Amen. Amen. Let's stand and let's sing the hymn, I Love Thee. I love thee. I love thee, my Lord. Let's begin.
Oh,
Something with his heart, blood pressure, here. And I have Alex down there, but it's
Alexis.
Alexis, who has the flu. All right. Others this morning.
My Aunt Linda.
Your Aunt Linda?
There was an ambulance at her house this morning, but we don't know why.
Okay. Dear Jesus, we thank you that we can come and we can lift up needs. You are fully aware, but you've asked us to be go-betweens, intercessors for her. So we do. God, we pray for Travis, and with whatever it is, the heart or blood pressure, or if it's something that's triggered, God, that you would help them figure that out. We pray for Doug and Regina as they are in quarantine, and just I thank you that the test results were negative, but we just continue to pray for them. We pray for Alexis with the flu, and just not just for her, but all those in the household. That you would keep that contained for Angela under hospice care. Be not only with her, but her family. For Robin's aunt, Linda, God again, not knowing what you do, we pray for her. God, I pray for Joyce. I pray for minimal lasting effects from this stroke. Help her as she recovers from it, as well as this surgery. God, I pray for Jonathan. Just, again, not hearing the word, but just knowing that he had medical needs too. And God, we pray for these families, the Mayfield family, for the Roy Coffee family. The grace in me. And as Cynthia is playing, it is well, it is well. And God, no matter what it is, no matter what storm comes our way, Lord, you are sovereign, you are over. You can heal, you can help us endure. So I pray these that you would be glorified in how you answer. In your name I pray, Jesus. Amen. If you would turn your Bibles to Exodus chapter 34. I begin with a confession. It's so funny how Steve perked up. What? Yes, I have a confession. Sometimes I can be a bit dim. Some nods out there. There are times I'm not all that bright. Especially when it comes to picking up the carpet. But anyway, now there's multiple meanings there. It's probably all applicable to me. But Jesus said, "You're the light of the world. A city set on a hill cannot be hid, nor does anyone light a lamp and put it under a basket, but on a lampstand. It gives light to all those who are in the house. Let your light shine before men in such a way that they can see your good works and glorify your Father who is in heaven. Let me repeat. Sometimes I'm a bit dim. And I'm not all that bright. Are you too? Jesus left it to us. You're it. You're the light. Shine. And so we're going to be looking back at Exodus 34 about a story of a man who literally shone. You could have taken him into a dark room and read a book. And so I'd like us to look at Moses. Moses was in the presence of God. He received the renewed covenant that was broken in short order. And God says, let's put two new tablets and we'll do it again. He saw a glimpse of God's glory. Again, if you want to hear more about that, listen to last week's message. And so we pick up after 40 days of Moses being in the presence of God, another 40 days. He had been there 40 days and then another 40 days. We pick up in Exodus chapter 24, verse 29. And here's the story. When Moses came down from Mount Sinai with the two tablets of the testimony in his hands, he was not aware that his face was radiant because he had spoken with the Lord. When Aaron and all the Israelites saw Moses, his face was radiant, and they were afraid to come near him. How would you feel if somebody walked into a room and their light not lit up, but lit out? You'd probably be fearful too. Or was this person close to a reactor? Or some other thing? What's this kind of freaky and all that? And it was freaky to them. They're like, have you ever seen anybody whose face glowed before? But Moses called him in. So Aaron and all the leaders of the community came back to him, and he spoke to them. So Aaron and the rest of the leaders, they get as close as they kind of feel comfortable. And yes, this is Moses, and he's still the same. He's still glowing, though, and this is kind of scary. And so he speaks to them, and because it was okay, they're okay, they survived. So afterwards, all the Israelites came near him, and he gave them all the commands the Lord had given him on Mount Sinai. And so all the things that you can read in the middle part of chapter 34 that God said, here's a couple additional things other than what I've already said. Moses shares these things with them. When Moses finished speaking to them, he put a veil over his face. But whenever he entered the Lord's presence to speak with them, he removed the veil until he came out. Now, this is a reference to a couple chapters earlier where there was before the tabernacle has been built. It's not built yet. So they had this other tent, and they call it the tent of meeting. And anybody was allowed to go in, but when Moses showed up, God showed up in a manifest way. And so when Moses, from this point on, would go in and he would talk with God, he'd take the veil off. And guess what happened? Because he spent time with God. When he came out and told the Israelites what had been commanded, they saw that his face was radiant. It was glowing. And Moses would put the veil back over his face until he went to speak with the Lord. And so this happened multiple times. As long as there was the tent of meeting before the tabernacle, Moses would go in and unveil and speak with God, and then he'd come out and he'd say what God said, but his face was glowing. And then when he was done, he'd cover it up again. Could you imagine? Could you imagine having your quiet time in the morning? And you pray with God, and God speaks to you through his word, and then your child wakes up and comes, and you're sitting there on the couch, and you're glowing. Mom, Daddy, glowing again. Anyway, you know, wouldn't that be, that just kind of be unique? Wow, what a unique situation. Wow, wouldn't that be neat if we all glowed? We do. One side note, what a good pattern Moses is given. Before he met with people, he met with God. Before he would speak with people, he spoke with God. Oh, if we would follow that, hey, before I have that talk with that person, God, I need your words. Well, what a great pattern. How many times can we just speak our mind? And people would hear. I think that happens every week. Oh, that we would spend time with God. So then when we spend time with people, there's a difference. They can hear the word. I'd like us to look, and I just have it up here on the screen, so you don't have to turn it there, but this is where I'm going to be the remainder. It's 2 Corinthians chapter 3, starting at verse 7. He talks about what we just read. And so I'm going to read some, talk some, because what this does is it says, believe it or not, how awesome that story about Moses coming down and glowing, and when he goes into the tent and meets with God, he comes out and he's glowing. As great as that is, according to Paul, we have something greater. Let's look at that. Because, you know, actually, there's not much application. Try to glow, you know. Now, the ministry that brought death, I'll explain what this is in just a minute. Now, the ministry that brought death, which was engraved in letters on stone. Okay, what are we talking about? The old covenant, the Ten Commandments, the thou shalt not, thou shalt not, thou shalt not. Okay, so if the ministry that brought death, which was engraved in letters on stone, came with glory, what glory? So that the Israelites could not look steadily at the face of Moses because of its glory, fading as it was. So this is referring back to this story that when Moses came back down and he had the new set of Ten Commandments that had been etched in stone and all this, and there was glory and all that. He's saying, listen, if that ministry, which results in death, talk about it in just a little bit, was glorious. Verse 8, will not the ministry of the Spirit be even more took on flesh, lived a life where there was no sin. In action, in inaction, in thought. And so the new covenant, it depends how well Jesus obeyed, and he did, and he offers life. You can't do it if it's based on how good you are. You're not good enough. But that's not what it's based on. If you would receive my son Jesus, it's how he was obedient. And so as we read through this passage, two more lines. The law gives rules. We can't keep them. The Spirit enables us to live for him. One, we're depending on ourselves to do it and we'll fail. The other is when we depend on the Spirit to do it. And he enables us. The Old Covenant, just from what we read, it's either of the law, the Old Testament's of the law, the New Covenant is of the Spirit, the Old Covenant brought death, the New Covenant brings freedom. It's many verses down, but this is what it brings to us. Let's continue reading in 2 Corinthians 3. Because it keeps going back. If this old ministry was then, how much more? So if the ministry that condemns men is glorious, it came with glory. It's not that there was a problem with the law, the problem is thus. If the ministry that condemns men is glorious, how much more glorious is the ministry that brings righteousness? And again, the old covenant, it condemns. All it can do is say, here's the rules and you've broke them. The new covenant brings us righteousness of Christ. How much more glorious? Verse 10. For what was glorious has no glory now in comparison with the surpassing glory. Now listen, this is Paul, inspired by the Holy Spirit, in talking about it, saying what Moses had and the glory he experienced is nothing. Since we have such hope, the hope that is not based on what we do or don't do, it's based on what Christ did for us, and we have hope, since we have such a hope, we are very bold. We are not like Moses, who would put a veil over his face to keep the Israelites from gazing at it while the radiance was fading away. See, it wasn't just about, people might have put sunglasses on when Moses was around because he was so bright. It was actually, he was in the presence of God and he got this new burst of glory and he came out shining. But he went out of the presence of God. The glory faded away. Talk a little bit about that, just a little bit. But the minds, their minds, the Israelites that saw Moses and said, oh, you're too bright. Their minds were made dull. For to this day, the same veil remains when the old covenant is read. Now, please, don't get that wrong. And somehow that says, therefore, we don't go to the Old Testament. No, that's not what it's talking about. It's talking about not just when it's read, but it's when it's read and you don't see it in light of the new covenant. It has not been removed only because in Christ it is taken away. This whole veil that is between us and God, that is in the way because we can never attain the righteousness we need. Even to this day, when Moses is read, when it's only read in the context of, oh, I better do these, instead of Christ, thank you for doing this for me. A veil covers their heart. But whenever anyone turns to the Lord, the veil is taken away. And the Lord is the Spirit. And when the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Now, when we focus on what we do, I got a church here, and I got to give. Listen, thank you. I've got to do this, 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 or else God's going to be mad at me. When you focus on what you do or we do, being transformed into his likeness with ever increasing glory. Literally, glory upon glory, which comes from the Lord, who is the Spirit. See, we spend time with God. We have a clearer view than Moses had who God is. Because we have a great revelation of who God is through his son Jesus. So if we have a great revelation of who God is that Moses had, won't that glory be even greater? Chapter 4. For God who said, let light shine out of darkness, may his light shine in our hearts to give us the light and the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of Christ. See, here's the thing. Moses, he would enter God's presence, and therefore he would glow. But then he would leave God's presence, because God's presence was only in this tent. And so as long as you go to the tent, all right, light up my life, God, and then you go out and you live for a little while, and then it dims. Listen, that's sometimes how we view it. We come into church and we're going to get our batteries charged, our light up, a little bit more, all that, and then we go out and by Tuesday it's pretty dim. But see, we have something far greater. We don't have to go to a special place. We have the Spirit of God in us. So where is God? He's not a tent. He's not a building. For believers, he's in the heart. And so he's always with you. And if he's always with you and you're acknowledging his presence, you glow. You won't be dim. You never lose his presence. But we need to acknowledge his presence. 1 Corinthians 4 continues. It changed the picture of being this light to being a treasure. We have this treasure in jars of clay. See, it's not about us. Look at me, I'm glowing. this treasure in jars of clay, show that this all-surpassing power is from God and not us. We are hard-pressed on every side, but not crushed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not abandoned. Struck down, but not destroyed. In other words, no matter who or whatever this world does to you, the more we are squeezed, the more Jesus comes out. Sometimes God lets us go through it, so we let Him. We're reminded that we're just jars of clay and the treasure's Him. And He is squeezed out. So here's a question. When life squeezes you, what comes out? Are we acknowledging God's presence with us all the time? It says we carry around in our body the death of Jesus, so that the life of Jesus may also be revealed in our body. Remember what Jesus said? He says, you've got to deny yourself. You've got to die to yourself. And that's when you're going to find life. It's when we're not living for ourselves, but living for Him, that His life is revealed in our bodies. For we, who are alive, are always being given over to death for Jesus' sake, so that this life may be revealed. His life may be revealed in our own lives. So instead of complaining, anybody here complain? Only me and Wanda, Rachel, Charles. We shine. Instead of worrying, we shine His peace. Instead of fighting back, getting even, we shine His love. Instead of fretting, that first one, complaining. Here's one verse about that. Do everything without complaining and arguing, so that you may become blameless and pure children of God without fault in a crooked and depraved generation in which you shine like stars in the universe as you hold out the word of life. Listen, when we, listen, He is always with us, so that glory is always available. The problem is we're walking our lives like He's not with us. And we're dependent on ourselves instead of Him. When we learn what that means, we start shining. And we're going to say, oh, I'm going to try not to complain. No, no, no. He'll just shine out not complaining. Listen, when we're doing those things that, you know, when we're instead of complaining, instead of worrying, instead of when we're doing the complaining and the worrying and the getting and eating and all that other stuff, it's a sign that we are not acknowledging. See, when we spend time with God, we have a clearer view of who He is through Jesus. And we have more glory to shine. I had that up there earlier. So, am I shining? When I go to school, am I shining? I'm around the neighborhood. chronic in need. Listen, if it's about you trying to push out the light to shine or the fruit to, for others, it's not going to happen. Focus on clinging to me. You'll shine. Fruit will come. I'm the vine. You are the branches. He who abides in me and I in him, he bears much fruit. For apart from me, you can do nothing. In Russia. Check to see if the power cord is plugged in. Am I connecting? Am I clinging to? For as long as we are depending on him, and this is not just something you go to church and get and then walk away, it's something that continues with you every day. God, I'm not shining unless I know how to get unplugged. God, that when that came out of me, oh. There's Bill. You don't have to come back in here. You don't have to go see somebody special. You just need to say, God, I need to spend some time with you. And listen. When we do, we will shine. And just like that verse we talked about, we're complaining or arguing, let this wicked generation see us shine. See the difference Christ makes. Not you trying to live like Christ, but Christ living through you. Shine. Listen, you have to have Christ in you to have Christ shine through you. And so do you have that relationship? It's not about going to church, and though it's a good thing, it's not about doing good things. It's good to do good things, but listen, it's when we realize that we don't have enough good to offer because we're sinners. And we come dependent on him and saying, I need you, Jesus, to save me. But it doesn't stop there. It is every moment, not day, moment of our life. I must abide. I must cling. I must stay plugged in. And he is there available. The Spirit of God is in you. Be filled with the Spirit. And we will shine. In a dark, wicked world. Let's pray. Jesus, as I started, there are days, many more, that I am in. Because I'm relying on you and not on you, Jesus. God, would you show me? It is still, I partly don't get it, God. When I look at Moses, who literally shone, and then I read your New Testament and says, there's something better. You should be shining more.